We're going to stay online, and I see you're there, Brandon. So welcome virtually to the day. And thank you very much for coming in to join us.
Thank you very much, Jan. And thank you very much, everybody, for inviting me to speak this afternoon. I'm going to just share some slides with you now and talk to them, and then I'll talk about the slides later. I've only been able to listen to the last hour or so of the presentations because I've been actually teaching all day here in the Netherlands. So I've missed some probably wonderful celebrations of Jeffrey and his work. But I'm going to focus my reflections on some of the issues that were addressed by Leonardo and Gloria earlier regarding his theoretical engagement and his journey in that regard. And then I'll spend a little bit of time at the very end just reflecting on my own experiences of working with him, because I did work with Jeffrey for nigh on 23 to 24 years. We met each other as part-time PhD students struggling with 16 to 18 hour teaching loads back a long, long time ago. And the first thing I want to do is I want to look at Jeffrey's work around accountability, because that's a very key theme that was embedded in all of his work. And people have spoken about that in the past hour as well. But I want to look at one aspect that I've always really enjoyed about the way he addressed issues of accountability, because it also reflected the way he taught and the nature of the person he was. And as Dave Owen and Rob Gray did in their initial work on broader notions of accountability, he always linked accountability to seeking responsibility and owning duties for particular actions and behaviors. But when Jeffrey tried to think about issues around accountability, he always imbued his thinking with contemporary resonance. He was always trying to locate his thinking within what was actually happening, not just in the broad business domain, the wider societal domain in which he was operating. And I learned this a lot from working very closely with him in his thinking on these issues. And he had a very careful approach, reasoned approach to thinking about accountability, the notion, and also linking it sometimes to notions of risk and how risk was conceived and how risk was presented. And that mightn't seem evident to some people who've read his work, but to me, who worked closely with him, it was something that pervaded much of what he did over his career. Now, to reflect on this, I just want to think back to the way in which he constructed a reasoned argument around the extent to which we should hold NGOs who advocate for certain issues accountable for their advocacy. Now, this was expressed in a paper in 2006 quite clearly. And I'm going to outline some elements of the paper to make the point about how he went about his thought process. And he always started off with decision frames, whereby he would ask a question, well, are entities accountable to all those upon whom their actions can have a direct or indirect impact? Very broad question. And in asking that very broad, simple question, he would then draw on various theoretical perspectives. In this case here, on perspectives on relational accountability, the extent of accountability owed to various stakeholder groups, and on notions of identity accountability regarding how individuals themselves may feel responsible for being accountable. And that was very relevant to the NGO advocacy domain he wanted to study. But in asking questions like this in the context of NGO advocacy, he was trying to work out, what do you think and how do you reason through whether these entities, these organizations, have direct and indirect responsibilities? And the idea behind his theorizing in these areas was to offer a reasoned viewpoint and ask you to think with him along these lines. And this again reflected very much the character Jeffrey actually was. And if you thought, for example, entities did have these broad responsibilities, then he asked, well, in the context of NGO advocacy, is there or are there certain types of advocacy which are definitely effective in making people do things, in mobilizing people to do things? And again, he asks a simple question and then he draws in the theory. In this case, here, mobilizing the work of the risk sociologist Ulrich Beck to try and understand how NGOs operate in what Beck calls a sub-political arena, an arena where informal interactions take place through lobbying, et cetera, and where experts and so-called counter-experts compete to try and grab attention and to influence behavior. And you can see what I mean by contemporary events, linking to Jeffrey now. And he asks about whether you believe that counter-experts like NGOs can, in some sense, strive to produce outcomes they want in this area. How can they actually work to produce what they want? Is it possible or not? Think about this. And so in developing his notion of accountability and the extent to which they should be held accountable for their advocacy, he asks a reader to think along with him. He doesn't tell you, He asks you to think with him, and he brings you with him by drawing on theory to try and inform what he's doing. And as I'll mention later on in my talk, it's not just about Jeffrey being used by theory. He uses theory to make his arguments and to make you think. Now, if you agree with the fact that NGOs can have this power in next sub-political arena, Jeffrey will then say to you, okay, many of these organizations produce what he calls linear predictive narratives, narratives which predict a certain future based on certain actions, a certain form of conception of risks and how risks will play out in society in relation to certain issues. And in his deliberation on whether these narratives are going to be deemed plausible to convince enough people to move in that direction or not, he actually thinks about the issue of how implausible experts might be deemed by so-called counter-experts like NGOs. So he sets up this arena where he gets you to discuss and think about the idea as to whether NGOs' linear predictive narratives can have some traction within the context of the theorizing of Beck. And he asks you to ask yourself, will counter-experts like NGOs be able to come up with plausible actual reasons for what they're saying and plausible enough reasons to get you to go with them and to act in the way they want you to act? And of course, in this context, he used an example in his paper of the controversy around the MMR vaccine in the UK, talking about how counter-experts can convince enough individuals about their conceptions of the risks from MMR to actually try and shift policy. Now, where am I seeing that in the current environment? Now, in looking at this accountability for NGO advocacy and whether you believe in this accountability or not, he asks you to think about whether, in fact, his examples and his approach here convinces you that counter-expert views can actually have the potential to be accepted by enough individuals and organizations to make a difference. If you accept that, he then asks, well, do these narratives then also have strong enough, substantial enough rhetorical power to really mobilize change, to bring change about, be it positive change or negative change? So he talks about the rhetorical power of linear predictive narratives, all the time drawing on Beck's conceptions. And then he talks about this subpolitical arena and how when you have these informal interactions among experts and so-called counter-experts, does the rhetorical power of certain NGOs have potential to make change and bring about change? He talks about the focus of NGOs on their brands and trying to convince with this rhetorical instruction. And then at the end of all of this, he asks you as a reader to say to yourself, okay, if you actually come along with the yes arrows in my conceptualization here, then you actually believe that highly trusted NGOs, yeah, may be held responsible and accountable for a broad range of direct and indirect outcomes resulting from their advocacy activities. Now, there's two things about this that sum up some things about Jeffrey for me. On the left-hand side of my slides, you've got fairly straightforward thinking process going on, leading you in a logical direction. On the right-hand side of the slide, he's using theory to help him enable you to think and come to certain conclusions. He's not telling you how to think. He is leading you in a certain direction, but he's also telling you you can drop off any stage. And then when he gets here, he elaborates on how this responsibility and accountability might arise. So this, to me, to an extent, illustrates the core character of Jeff, this reasoned theoretical argument, enabling you as a reader to decide the extent of accountability, if any, NGOs who advocate should be held to. He subjects all positions to counter-arguments and then illustrates the extent to which he was always a reasoned and reasonable academic. When I say reasonable academic, I don't mean reasonable in the context of the quality of his work. I mean in the way he carried himself in general. And I think in the discussions of accountability that Gloria alluded to, and that Leonardo alluded to, this paper for me was always one whereby you could see the individual, how he thought, but also how he theorized coming through extremely clearly in a very, very powerful manner. And it's why I've tried to just briefly today reflect on that in the context of the contribution Jeffrey made much more broadly to issues concerning accountability. Now, Jeffrey, in the context of looking at accountability, also did always engage with theorists who want to look at issues of risk and risk in society and in organizations in general. And what many people mightn't be aware of is he actually tried at one stage to develop much clearer and developed and cohesive ideas around corporate social disclosure as a so-called hegemonic discourse of risk, as a way of engaging in a risk discourse. And he was doing this back in 2004. Now, if you look at the recent developments that Jeffrey was involved in soon before his death around TCFD reporting and risk reporting generally, you'll see he came back to that. And it was something which was always lying there around for him to come back to in his career. Some of it came to the fore in the chapter that was written for the A4S book in 2009, for the Prince of Wales project. But he never really managed to come back to it in its core, while having engaged in great depth with it in his career early on. But you'll see in a moment, probably a rather sad feature of my presentation, that he was about to come back to this area of accountability and its relation to risk and risk discourse in great depth in his later days. When Jeffrey joined the Pentland Centre, the risk notion and the connection between accountability and risk started to come back to the fore. He was absolutely thrilled to work on the project when Pentland was providing some consulting advice to a major French multinational on their engagement with the Task Force for Climate-Related Financial Disclosures. And what I noticed about that process he went through was he started to move from thinking about accountability and risk and to think more about uncertainty, moving towards the notion of uncertainty as opposed to the notion of risk, which has probabilities attached to it. And in that, he was becoming intrigued by notions around scenario analysis and how companies might report on scenario analysis and cope with scenario analysis. And indeed, he advised on this in the work he was involved in Pentland. So the idea of accountability for risk, uncertainty, and opportunities was starting to become very prevalent in his work. And then in 2020, we published a paper together reviewing the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures agenda and setting out some research suggestions in that particular area. And in the discussions that we had then, we had decided, as I'll allude to in a moment, to finally get back to working intensely together on a project after having not worked intensely on one big project for a number of years. And that was as a project that was going to be engaging with members of the TCFD and the broader field within which the TCFD was emerging. And it was going to go right back to the engagement Jeffrey had with risk notions and their attachment to accountability in the early to mid 2000s. Unfortunately, we didn't get a chance to progress that. But in some sense, I wanted to relay that to you because this was the direction that he was going in. And his unfortunate passing means we'll never really get to know where he would have gone with that. Now, in the context of theory, people have talked about theory and Jeffrey's allusions to theory. Jeffrey was never a fan of theory for the sake of theory. And the title of this slide is deliberate, using as opposed to being used by theory. He saw theory as something that should be used in a rather instrumental manner in lots of ways. And however, having said that, if I look back at his work, which I've done in preparation for my talk to you this afternoon, he contributed so much to developing theory and to using theory in a way that allowed him to express ideas that always had serious practical significance. For example, the early work with Linda, and it's brilliant to know that Linda is here in the online chat with Linda Lewis, in implanting ethical relativism in CSD research, was initially going to be part of his PhD, but was published in CPA in, I think it was 1999, in one of his first pieces of work in this area. He then went on to reinvigorate Habermas's ideal speech situation in work he published in AOS in 2004 on stakeholder engagement and stakeholder accountability in relation to Shell, no doubt influenced to some extent by his close association with the wonderful Richard Loughlin. He also advanced notions of legitimacy theory in his work on assurance, in trying to offer more in-depth conceptualizations of the theory, but also in order to enable and encourage people to start thinking about practice in this area in a much more complex, but also a much more enlightening way. He moved on to use theory, like Giddens' mechanisms of modernity, to explain withdrawals of trust in systems of audit and accounting after the Enron collapse. But again, italicize using. He used the theory to enable him to say something, and to enable him to conceptualize something in always an accessible manner. He re-theorized how organizational fields get formed when looking at integrated reporting and its evolution, something that Leonardo alluded to a moment ago. He reconceptualized a accounting for externalities in his ABR paper a few years ago. And the key thing about what he was doing there was he was actually reintroducing wonderful work which people like Jan Bevington and Rob Gray had been doing back in the 1990s, actually, which to my in my mind was largely getting ignored with this rush to embrace externalities in practice. In all of this, Jeffrey was trying to extend notions of accountability and trying to implant ideas from practice in the brains of academics and also trying to, in some way, engage with practice. I mean, the reconceptualization of accounting for externalities was part of a PD Leak lecture he made for the ICAW. But a very important part of Jeffrey's engagement was he was always conscious of echo chambers. He was conscious of academic echo chambers, as you can see from his BAR plenary speech a number of years ago. But he was also highly conscious of echo chambers in the context of how academics use theory. And this is always very important to him and came up regularly in the conversations we had. Is what's the point if you're not making the theory do something for you to make the point you want to make, as opposed to you being trapped by your desire to show the theory in some way in an academic paper? And that links very much to this impact and practice-oriented focus Jeffrey had in his career that both Leonardo and Gloria alluded to in their earlier conversations. I worked with Jeffrey, as I've said, for a very long time. Now, this is the part of the presentation where I might get a bit upset, but I won't. Okay, I hope not. I did a count. We wrote 18 academic papers together, and I couldn't believe it. And the reason I couldn't believe it, everyone, because, and you won't believe this, writing with this guy was the most pleasant experience I've ever had in a working relationship. It was smooth, it was fun, it was rigorous. We had wonderful arguments, which always ended with somebody giving in, but also with a lot of laughter. And we were very, very hard on each other. But the thing is, it never felt like working with this individual, never. And that was probably because in some senses we were similar, but in other ways we were completely different. And so in all my career, the thought of working with Jeffrey was always a pleasure, and it just happened very naturally. And by the way, I will take credit for us working together, because it took me about 18 months to convince him, come on, we have to do something to get together at some stage, because he was so busy with various things in his career when I was pushing him on that. And I met Jeffrey in 1997 at the Interdisciplinary Perspectives on Accounting Conference in Manchester. And the reason I got speaking to Jeffrey was I was in the middle of almost an existential crisis during the conference, because all I saw around me were angry people. Angry critical scholars screaming at each other, screaming at Rob Gray, screaming at Dave Owen and people like this in this environment. I'd never been at an academic conference before, or met some of the people I met there before in my entire life. And I remember sitting at one stage, and I was thinking of starting a PhD at this stage, I remember sitting down in a corner, just trying to catch my breath, having seen some of the rather caustic debates going on in the various seminars, when Jeffrey passed by, mentioned he'd heard about me from, maybe I think it was Ian Thompson, who at the time was quite dashing, walking around wearing sunglasses in Manchester, by the way. And he said, what did you think of some of those seminars? And I said, well, Jeffrey, I found some of it rather disconcerting. And he just calmed me down straight away and said, listen, you've got to put this thing into perspective. There are performers in many of these domains, and many people are here to perform. And from there, we actually got to know each other quite well. And in fact, so well that I met him in London in late 1999, just after I'd submitted the first draft of my PhD. Second draft of my PhD. And I told him with great glee, now, Jeffrey, this is done. I think I'm going to leave academia. And he brought me to a rather noisy pub in the middle of London to actually talk me out of the idea of walking away from academia, even though I had very serious plans in place at that time. Gloria alluded to our trip to Ghana. I was there in the summer of 2008. And that was an absolutely incredible experience working with Jeffrey, because you got to see him in a very different context. We gathered data together in very conventional contexts as well over his career. But in Ghana, I could never picture Jeffrey roughing and tumbling in Ghana before we went there. But as Gloria will confirm, he was quite good at it, because it was a very intense period and an incredibly insightful and interesting period as well, gathering that data among those local communities at the time we were actually there. But there I saw a side of Jeffrey too, that everybody has talked about. The, incredible empathy he had for individuals in all sorts of different contexts, wherever they came from, and also his incredible ability to engage with people at whatever level in society and in the domains that he moved in. And that was something that stuck with me all the time I met him. One thing about Jeffrey in working with him was he was a great guy for giving me advice. And I gave him advice as well, I must say. But he was also a great guy for giving me advice that he completely ignored himself. I won't tell you about some of the details here, but it happened quite often. And I'll often point this out to him when he did it. And those of you who know Jeffrey well would know about his raising of the eyebrow or the eyebrows and just expressing the word quite. Did that an awful lot with me when we actually engaged together and had debates about me complaining that you're giving me all this advice now, Jeffrey. But listen, if I look at you, you completely ignore it yourself. So even though Leonardo has alluded to the advice Jeffrey gave and Jeffrey's mentoring, which was absolutely fantastic, I saw it firsthand, he did have a habit sometimes in my experience of ignoring his own advice as well and then smiling about it and telling me to get on my right. In the work with Jeffrey, we did other things without, apart from working together as well. We worked on different individual projects. I'm somebody who tends to stick with things until it becomes desperate, and only then will I stop with it. He would continually talk to me about sunk costs and about avoiding sunk costs and stopping and moving on. And he saved me from myself on many occasions and projects I was doing on my own. But one thing I will say to you quite clearly here today, and this is something that I've alluded to earlier, is that I never had a situation with Jeffrey where we did not finish something. We always finished stuff we started. It's incredible. And it wasn't out of a sense of compulsion. It was out of a sense of the sheer enjoyment of doing it. And also because we're both very, very stubborn individuals in many respects. But we never, ever, ever stopped. We kept going. And I suppose one of the most disconcerting, sad parts of me talking to you this afternoon is that we had decided, we met together in Manchester in March 2019, and we said, we've got to start working together on some major project. We're very productive. We love it. We have great fun together. And we were going to work, and we had actually got ethical clearance for a major project to work together on the evolution of the task force on climate-related financial disclosures. We never got the chance. And now this is a sole-authored study I am working, and I will complete in his memory. While I'm getting a little upset at the end of this presentation, it's worth then quickly switching to a final wonderful memory. This is Jeffrey's wedding day in July 2007. It remains the only wedding my other son Tim has ever been at, actually, in his life. He was 3 years of age at the time. It's a memory I'd like to leave you with. It's three smiling people, and it's Jeffrey. Thank you.